York City. Thank you, thank you. I wondered what my walk-up music was going to be. I wanted Lover Boy. Loving every minute of it. I actually have a list on Spotify called walk-up music when I really want to get myself going. Today, I'm going to talk about a game changer, blockchain. I think there's been so much hot air on blockchain over the last year or two that it's affecting global warming. So my intent today is to give you a framework and then tell you a little bit about the IBM Mediaocean partnership pilot that we have with 8 global brands applying blockchain in media. So with that, I'm going to start. Here we go. I'm going to start in one place, to show of hands, who feels like they have a really good sense of what blockchain actually is, either in general or in media. And don't be shy. And if you raise your hand, I'll call you up here and you can do this presentation. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm gonna start in really the setup, which is, if you close your eyes and you think about what the world looks like in 20 years for a CMO, a head of media, a head at the agency, an investment lead, I always think about a Star Trek dashboard or VR, and I'm standing in front of it and I'm interacting with the data, and I've got brand health metrics, I've got my sales over here, and I basically have the entire customer journey, and I'm interacting and pulling and pushing the data. But the reality is, we're not even close to being there. And I think Jeff talked about it earlier, we are in a step function amount of change that's happening. So when I always frame up blockchain, I always talk about the very first thing, which is the Maslow's hierarchy for media, which is, if you break down what is happening in our industry, you have underlying hardware, software, data, regulatory frameworks, laws, standards, and then people, organ, process. And if you think about every single level there is transformative change that is happening. And we're all trying to make changes at every single level to change the way we buy and sell media, plan, buy, sell, pay for media. And I would argue that it's really in the hardware space that we've begun to see some stabilization. And the metric there is how much consolidation has happened and how much price commoditization. In the last 4 years, AWS pricing to their clients has gone down 3 to 4x. In 3 or 4 years, that's massive. So what's happening is we're starting to see from the bottom up consolidation and standardization and convergence. And so the end state of that is that 20 years from now dashboard where I am interacting and all my TV buyers understand digital and my digital buyers understand spot TV and they all have a combined Nielsen ComScore. I don't know who the data provider will be that you can use for targeting, planning, and measurement. But that's the end state. But we're not even really close to being there. And so with that, I'm going to give you a little bit more context on why I'm up here. I work for Mediaocean. Mediaocean is the foundational software that all the holding companies and a number of large brands use to plan, buy, and bill pay all of their media across traditional and digital. So we process about $140 billion in transaction volume. It's about half traditional and half digital. And you'll see our numbers mirror what's going on in the industry, which is traditional is like this, and digital is like this. So we're providing the financial and data and operational workflow that many of you touch. If you're at an agency or if you're at a brand, these are the products that we have, but it is effectively an ERP for the financial, contractual, and operational side of the business. Very right brain stuff. So with that context, what we have seen over the last few years, and I would say in the last 10 to 12 years, when programmatic started, and programmatic used to be unsold inventory, and I'm using some behavioral data to do that. And I think it's evolved. So my definition of what programmatic is a massive amount of data and a massive amount of automation and convergence. And that is no longer a part of media. It's an overall framework of thinking about how you plan, buy, measure, pay, if you're talking about the buy side, and or how you monetize, how you create content, how you distribute it, how you monetize it, and how you measure it. It's the same circles, just different language that buyers and sellers actually use. So I think we are in a period that Joanna O'Connell at Forrester calls the accountable marketing phase of media. And by that, I mean marketing that has clear and direct line of sight into what is the enterprise value of a dollar of media that I spend, okay? And often that hasn't been the case. Obviously, everyone knows the Wanamaker quote. But in a state where you have technology and you have convergence of technologies, you have a massive amount of data and all this automation happening, everyone is thinking actually the same thing, which is we can combine this stuff together and have a clear view on what a dollar of marketing will do relative to going out and building new product, relative to creating a different retail or e-commerce strategy, relative to and acquiring a company. So all these marketers are thinking about accountable marketing. Gone are the days of a CMO who is just the big creative person who comes in and buys TV spots. It is the CMO who's also a CIO and has technology chops too. So foundationally, what we talk about in the marketing accountable framework is all these pieces, which is really just taking that Maslow's hierarchy stack and saying prescriptively, what do we need to do as an organization? How do we think about technology? How do we think about partners? How do we think about data so that it allows us to do this efficiently and effectively? Now, over the last few years, I think it was 17 that digital eclipsed traditional in terms of spend. These are global numbers. It roughly mirrors in terms of slope of the line what's happening in the U.S. market. But what we're seeing is this increase. We all intuitively think in 10 or 20 years, all content will be delivered digitally via IP, whether it's OTT or a connected TV or whatever it is. And that we'll be using all of this data to target. Many of people intuitively this notion of programmatic thinking. But there are lots of problems here, and this is the chief officer of P&G, Mark Pritchard. And he has been very vocal and very constructively critical about all the problems that we see in digital. This is by industry research that says essentially the same thing, which is either we have business relationship problems. The A&A report from several years ago has been playing out. I think it's mostly played out in the industry. Or just issues related to digital advertising, media quality, transparency, and actually the ability to measure the ROI. Now I'm going to break that down a little bit more discreetly. A television buy, a classic television buy, whether we're talking about a national or a spot, is I'm an agency and I go out and I negotiate in an upfront and I negotiate directly. There are roughly 5 to 6 buyers and 13 sellers in that upfront that move billions of dollars. And that's the way it's been. And it's been very transparent. It's been measured by Nielsen for decades. People don't like Nielsen, but it's the lie that they know, not the truth that they don't understand. That's what a seller has said to me. And so this is transparent. Now let's talk about digital. Digital is I've got an SSP, and I'm not going to go through all the acronyms that were mentioned earlier. But all of this is intermediation. I think it's well-intentioned because you have VCs funding very discrete services, whether we're talking about viewability or video ad serving or OTT or whatever it is. You've got all these capabilities. And then you have supply intermediation, everyone trying to get to massive scale so they can use the data that they have that they license from a third party. So all of this intermediation has created an opaque market. So when you look at cross-media buying, which is what these global brands are doing in all these different countries with different infrastructure, this is huge, huge risk for big brands. They see it as an opportunity. P&G with Hawkeye even came out and said, it is orders of magnitude more efficient at driving sales, but we see that there are significant issues that come along with it. So summing up those issues, scattered data, opaque view, I think the scattered data, I think we try to combine it together as best as possible, but we're still falling well short of that. Opaque view, contract management, billing, if you look at how much it costs to actually execute television, it's less than 3%, what they call non-working media costs. That's your agency costs, that's the cost of the inventory, and that's the cost of the data. On the digital side, it's still 20 to 25%. So major brands look at this and go, God, how do we get visibility into this? How do we get a better sense of what's actually happening inside of this? Now, I'm going to talk about what blockchain is, but first I'm going to put up what I think is a fantastic definition. John Oliver, if you saw his spiel, everything you don't understand about accounting combined with everything that you don't understand about computers. It's a great example, but I'm going to try to make it a little bit more concrete. The Internet Advertising Bureau defines it as this. Let me use an example. I'm going to use an avocado because Yvonne was up here. I loved her presentation. IBM did a blockchain implementation with Walmart where they effectively tracked an avocado from the farm to the table and all the way through. Now, if you think about the old school way of doing that, people had databases or they had bills of lading and they had all these different paper versions or fragmented electronic versions of who the distributor was, who the wholesaler was, who the restaurateur was, all of those people all the way through, but they did not have a great way to capture that centrally. So if someone got food poisoning or there was a major outburst or infection, that could be immediately tracked all the way back. In media, that's effectively what we're trying to do, which is when P&G, when Unilever, when J&J, when AB InBev is taking a dollar of media and giving it as a purchase order to an agency to say, build me a cross-media plan that's global, that's local, regional, and global across different channels. How can I actually track it from a financial contractual perspective? And then how can I actually connect that to the performance? So when we think and talk about blockchain, there are layers of value in blockchain. And this goes from the bottom and it works its way up. And you have to nail the bottom before you can go all the way up. So the bottom layer is the financial and contractual. And that is in a media buy, when that brand provides a PO to the agency, and when the IOs go out to the sellers and all the data or the intermediaries, being able to write that in a distributed way with a smart contract that reflects what the order says and is able to quickly and in real time write to what is effectively, it's a ledger, but think of it, it's the difference between a Word document and a Google Doc. A Word doc is on my computer, I have it, I really can't share it. A Google Doc is cloud-based and I could permission access to that to a counterparty so they can see parts of the transaction. So foundationally, financial and contractual has to happen before anything else can happen. Above that, you will hear innovative startups, and I think AminoPay is one, Fusion 7, there are others, who are trying to solve very discrete pieces of digital advertising problems. Fraud is absolutely one. Reconciliation, another. There is one agency, I'll give you an example, there's one agency that has 20 people who do nothing but reconcile Facebook invoices against POs. Because there's a mismatch in the structure, it's a total mess. 80%+ of what they had in terms of invoices were discrepant. It's a massive expense for them. We've already started to solve that and have cut that time in half. So the supply chain transparency is the next level up. The next level up above that is consumer identity, which is really proof of identity, authentication that you are who you are. Now there's a B2C of that, and that could be like Facebook, but there's a B2B version. Right? A way you address fake news is make sure that you understand who the purveyor of that was, who the distributor was, and who the consumer was. So identity is a way for blockchain to be applied to create trust in a marketplace of people that are consuming different things, and be it content or money or other things. And then the last is, once you get all those participants and you have the B2B network of buyers and sellers and intermediaries, or you have all the consumers, then you can create trading opportunities, okay? So in our pilot, we've got, in Cannes we announced 5 brands. We've subsequently added 3, J&J, who else was added? AT&T, sorry. And this was focused on the foundational, contractual, and financial piece. And we included the agency partners, the main media agency partners, so that was 4 holding companies. And then we included some data and tech partners just as a way to show the brands what could happen when you begin to use a distributed ledger in a way that allows them to have access. Now this is a little unsettling for the ad agencies. The ad agencies have historically been the ad ledgers for all the media buying that these brands are doing. So they've controlled all the data. They've written it, it sits in our systems, but they're the only ones that have access to it. And if a brand says, hey, show me what I did last month across the US by channel, by media, they pull it, they massage that data. In a blockchain, that brand actually has a node themselves, they have a ledger themselves, and we are actively and in real time writing information in multiple places. Now they have this database that mirrors what the agency has, but they also have other agency relationships and the agency has other clients. So this is a full nodal network of data that's flowing back and forth. And so what we have found in the conversations were 3 big takeaways. Now we're 3.5 months in on the pilot. We're actively taking the media buy data, so that's POs, IOs, invoices, and payments, and writing those into blockchain. But a couple things that we have figured out. One, on the working media side, the brands do not believe, and agencies to some extent do not believe, that they've got enough visibility into what's actually happening underneath that initial transaction, underneath that initial IO. And they also believe that that they may be understating what the non-working media costs are. There's also some definitional problems, which is some people call non-working media, which is really all the cost that are included in executing media transactions. They call it different things. I'll give an example. Some brands will use data costs as a media cost because it used to be that way in television. It was all sort of baked in. The second thing is the programmatic cost, and this is where that intermediation, that graph that I showed you, the spider, really, where the brands really feel the pain of that. They feel the pain in a couple ways. One is they can't communicate with certainty what's going on underneath there, and it's also a risk, because once you give that control over when an ad serves to somebody, they can control the margin, they can also control the end place, and the last thing you want is a global brand ending up on a site that they shouldn't be. And then the last is the is the workflow piece, which is just how do the agency and the marketer, in a more programmatic world where planning and buying is far more iterative and it's happening like this and in real time, how does the agency and the brand work together much more tightly? How do they tightly couple the process, the reviews, the measurement? What does the brand want to take in-house and what does the agency want to continue to do? So as we have summarized this, we believe that blockchain, this distributed ledger, a new way of writing information between parties, can fix three things, and it's sort of left to right sequential. The first is what we call the painkiller, which is compliance. Now, if a CMO or head of media cannot say to the CFO that they understand with certainty what their media spend is by geo, by channel, by partner, it's actually an audit problem, which makes it far bigger problem than any other problem that they have. So there are audit and compliance concerns that we believe blockchain can address. Once you have that information, then you can begin to click down into what are your working media costs and what are your non-working media costs. As I said, 3%, less than 3% to execute television, 20 to 25% on the digital side. We think that that will collapse more for the tech and data providers, less for the agencies, less for the sellers, and less for the marketers, but we think there is a lot of obfuscation where there's a lot of margin inside there that will get revealed as blockchain gets adopted more and more. And then the last piece is, if you have this data in real time, and you're writing it and reviewing it, and you have business intelligence tools that are surfacing this data, you can actually make decisions far faster about how you move dollars around. And I think this is one of those media efficiency things. If you're, for example, re-rolling your allocation, your upfront allocation, once a month, what would the efficiency gains be if you did that weekly? We think there are significant gains to be had, and by automating the process, you can take the manual labor out and have the marketer and the agency focus on the real value, which is the interpretation of the data. So with that, you know, in this dynamic market, I always want to say like the so what. And I think the so what here is, for the marketers and the publishers, you have to lean in to the ad tech and data conversations. More and more, the role of the CMO is coordinating the marketing and data infrastructure for the company and for their partners. So I think that's critical. Next is the agencies. The agencies have really gotten a bad rap over the last year. Most of the apples in the barrel are fantastic apples. And I think the ANA report exposed some problems, but I think many of the agencies have leaned into this, the media agencies have leaned into this and become transparent. Brands can probably do a better job recognizing that agencies are providing key value. And historically, the brands have treated the agencies as slightly differentiated commodity services, and procurement has come in and bid them down. And that's caused a lot of problems for the agencies where they can invest in a time when we absolutely should be investing in the innovation. And then for everybody, I always say it, always be learning. I tell people I'm a paranoid optimist, which means I have American optimism. Everything is going to work out. 20 years from now, we are going to have the dashboards and it's going to be VR and there's going to be great dynamic business and we're going to grow the economy through that. But you have to be paranoid about the details. You have to be paranoid. You have to understand every layer of what's happening, who's doing what margins are they taking, and make good business decisions. So back to the basics of marketing accountability, and I'll make this deck available for anybody that wants it. I think these are foundational, they have to be cultural, and they have to be embedded into the company. So with that, I hope this was helpful in establishing an understanding of blockchain. Thanks.